So once you get things evaporating and have this vaporization process, you can have something called vapor pressure. So we're going to define what vapor pressure is and what affects the magnitude of vapor pressure. Okay? So we see a picture here of some water, let's say, yeah, that's definitely water, in a flask, and we've put a lid on it. Okay, now if we didn't put a lid on it, it could evaporate away completely and eventually be dry. But if we put a lid on it, it's still going to evaporate up to a point and get some water molecules into the gas phase. So what is vapor pressure? Vapor pressure is the pressure above the liquid, okay, in a sealed container of a specific liquid. So anytime you take a liquid, put a lid on it, some evaporation is going to occur. It's going to put some of that vapor into the gas, some of that liquid into the gas phase. We call that a vapor, okay? And we could actually measure that vapor pressure. We could see what kind of pressure is due just to that. Now, there might be some water molecules in there, I mean, some air molecules in there, some oxygen, some nitrogen gas in there. When we talk about vapor pressure, we're talking about the partial pressure only of the liquid that got into the vapor phase. Okay, so that's what a vapor pressure is. Now here's how you achieve a vapor pressure. To get from pure water in the bottom, and that's all that's there, and put a lid on it, to the point where you have reached this vapor pressure value, the first thing that's going to happen is you get some evaporation to occur. So some of the liquid is getting up into the gas phase, and we see up arrows. As soon as you get some liquid up there, some of those water molecules could lose enough energy and be trapped by the liquid below, reattracted to those molecules. So they're coming down, they bounce off that water surface, and if they don't have enough energy to escape, they stay. If they do, then they bounce right back off again. But some of them will be recaptured, okay? So once there are some in the gas phase, then condensation is going to be right on its heels, and you're going to get some condensation to occur. Now, there's going to be some point at which the rate of a molecule going into the gas phase and the rate of the molecules going back down into the getting condensed back to the liquid phase are equal to each other, okay? So every time one happens, the other one is condensed. One evaporates, one is condensed. When that is happening, we are what is called at a dynamic equilibrium. We're not seeing any overall change. There's not more liquid in the bottom. There's not more vapor in the above. The amount is the same in both, but there's a continual exchange of which molecules are in the liquid and which molecules are in the gas phase, okay? So once you've reached this point of equilibrium between the rate of evaporation and the rate of condensation, they're both happening exactly the same. We call this the equilibrium vapor pressure. Usually we throw the word equilibrium out, and this is its vapor pressure. So there is a vapor pressure in image B there, all right? But it's not its equilibrium vapor pressure. It's not the full vapor pressure it will get to. You put a lid on it, eventually you're not going to get any more additional molecules, number of molecules in the gas phase, and that is when we have achieved what we call our vapor pressure for that liquid. All right, so this image here is taking us through this process as time goes by. All right, so we start off right here at the very beginning, and we only have liquid in our container. If there's only liquid in our container and no vapor, we can only have evaporation. All right, so evaporation starts taking shape. And that's the red line. We have no condensation. Evaporation's rate is due to three things. We know it's due to temperature. Whoops, sorry. See if I can make this go backwards. It's due to temperature. And if we keep the temperature the same the whole time, we're going to have a steady rate of evaporation. It's due to surface area. We're not changing our container, so that's not changing, so we're keeping that at a steady rate. And it is based upon intermolecular force. Okay, it's the same liquid the whole time. So rate of evaporation is a nice, steady occurrence. But at the very beginning, there is no condensation. Condensation is here in blue. So at the beginning, there's zero condensation. But as we move along, as time goes by, we put some molecules in the gas phase. As soon as some molecules go in the gas phase, we can get some condensation to occur. As more and more molecules get into the gas phase, the rate of condensation keeps going up and up and up. And at some point, you're going to reach the part where the rate of evaporation and the rate of condensation are exactly equal. And from this point forward, we're at that dynamic equilibrium. And from this point forward, we can measure the vapor pressure, and it would be a constant pressure. The pressure is going up. Pressure is increasing, 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 and now the pressure is steady. Steady pressure of that vapor above the liquid. So, vapor pressure is going to depend upon temperature. We said that rate of evaporation depends upon temperature. So vapor pressure will also depend upon temperature. Let's think about how that happens and why that happens. What's occurring down on the molecular level? First, the how. How does it depend upon the temperature? Well, as the temperature increases, the vapor pressure will increase. Now you can just memorize those terms, but it's not very good just to memorize terms. We ought to understand the why that is. Okay, we know that as we increase the temperature, we're going to increase the rate. Remember this picture? As we increase the temperature, the rate of vaporization increases. These words are probably going to show up as I click. The rate of evaporation is increasing. This is something we already learned, but that's not vapor pressure. That's the rate of vaporization. Okay, higher average kinetic energy, greater rate of evaporation or vaporization, we already saw. So let's go back to our little line. Here is at T1, some temperature. Rate of evaporation, constant rate. Nice red line, straight line. Let's raise the temperature. Let's raise the temperature up to here. Now we're at T2. Higher temperature, higher rate of evaporation. All right, so we've got a rate of evaporation increasing, so what's going to have to happen here? It's going to take a little bit longer. A little bit more has got to get into the vapor phase. A little bit more has got to get in the vapor phase. A little bit more has got to get in the vapor phase before we finally get enough in the vapor phase so that we can reach that dynamic equilibrium. We weren't there here, okay? We're not at the dynamic equilibrium here. There weren't enough molecules in the vapor phase in order to condense at a fast enough rate. We had to keep on putting more and more up there. Thought I had a nice picture of that. Nope. Okay. So, let me just reemphasize that a bit more. We're saying that vapor pressure increases with temperature, and this is because the rate of evaporation up here has increased. It takes more molecules in the gas phase before the rate of condensation matches it, and so we have a greater pressure. See if I can make it work. There it goes. Well, vapor pressure is also going to depend upon the strength of the intermolecular forces. Okay, let's think about how and why. What happens to the rate of evaporation as the strength goes up? So let's go. Intermolecular force increases. Okay. What did the rate of vaporization do? The speed at which they evaporated. Well, they're more strongly held together. This slowed down. Okay. We could go back to our image again, and let's just do this real quick. That one. If we increase the strength, we're going to bring that line down here. It is going to meet that point sooner. It doesn't have to get as many molecules into the vapor phase. So what happens here? As the intermolecular force increases, the rate of vaporization slows down, and so there will be fewer molecules in the gas phase, fewer vapor molecules. therefore a lower vapor pressure. Here is several different images where we are following a substance through and seeing how the vapor pressure changes with temperature and changes with intermolecular force. Let's start with temperature. Let's follow this substance here. We see that as the temperature goes up, the vapor pressure is going up, okay? Here's another one. We see as the temperature goes up, the vapor pressure is going up. But let's compare two substances. Let's compare diethyl ether to water. Let's compare it right here. Let's compare it at 400. That's a nice line. Okay, let me erase that. Try it again. Erase. Okay, so at 400, okay, sorry, that's vapor pressure. Can't do it that way. Let's compare two things at the same temperature but different intermolecular forces. So we're going to compare water at 60 degrees and ethyl alcohol at 60 degrees. Water has a stronger intermolecular force than ethyl alcohol has. Because of that, at the same temperature, this has a greater vapor pressure. So we're seeing both the temperature's effect and the strength of the intermolecular forces effect. So in this image, the weakest intermolecular force is the diethyl ether up to ethylene glycol, which has got the strongest intermolecular force. So that's what we're seeing happening as we go there. So it's showing that the increased intermolecular force, as this increases, the vapor pressure is decreasing. IMF goes up, vapor pressure goes down. So we have all sorts of comparisons we can make between intermolecular force and a property of a liquid. All right, and this is our next one, vapor pressure. You're going to have a lower vapor pressure as that goes, as this goes up, the vapor pressure is going to go down. Now, let's mention boiling point. I said we would talk about boiling point and the difference between it. If the surface molecules are escaping, that's vaporization. If you get it to where there's rolling boil, bubbles rising to the surface and popping, we all know what it looks like when it boils. What is on the scientific definition of boiling point? Well, it is a temperature at which the vapor pressure of that liquid equals the external pressure. So let's follow water, for example. As the temperature goes up, the vapor pressure goes up. As the temperature goes up, the vapor pressure goes up. As the temperature goes up, the vapor pressure goes up. And it keeps going up, and it keeps going up, and eventually it matches external pressure. So let's say the external pressure is one atmosphere, okay? That's 760 torr. So at one atmosphere, we're going to have a vapor pressure of 100 degrees Celsius. When those things match, that is the definition of boiling point. And what happens at that point is, at the bottom of your pot, that will allow a bubble to form, and that bubble is going to rise to meet the pressure that's out here. So the pressure inside matches the pressure outside, and it can rise. Up until that point, the pressure outside is greater, and it'll force that to stay down there. And you'll watch a pot of water boil. For a while, you'll see bubbles form, but they never come off the bottom. And they collapse, and they form, and they collapse. But as the temperature rises and rises, eventually that pressure will be enough that it'll match the external pressure, and it'll rise to the top and be able to pop. And we see that, and we know that that's boiling, but this is the definition. So, weird definition, not one that you would have learned as a kid, but this is our chemistry definition. This is what's happening with the temperature and the vapor pressure that allows for boiling to occur. Now, what normal boiling point is, when I say that water boils at 100 degrees Celsius, I'm actually giving the normal boiling point. If the external pressure is one atmosphere, that's what normal boiling point is. So water boils at different temperatures depending upon what the external pressure is. The external pressure was not 760 torr, but was only 60 torr. We could read over here and we could say at 600 torr, it boils at, let's say, 95 degrees Celsius. So when you go to the top of Pike's Peak, or at a high elevation, things boil at lower temperatures. And they take longer to cook if you're cooking them in boiling water for that reason. All right, so here's your question. What is the connection between boiling point and intermolecular force? Go back and look at your image if you need to. All right, as intermolecular forces increase, the boiling points are increasing. So we're seeing another connection between IMF, and we had seen this actually before. I told you this before, that as intermolecular force increases, the boiling point increases, when we first introduced intermolecular force. But it has everything to do with vapor pressure and vaporization. That's why it does it once we, you know, we had a connection before, and now we have a why to that connection. All right, let's look at this image here real quick. Our last thing to look at here is called a heating curve. We're not going to do any calculations with this yet, but we will eventually before we leave this chapter. But I want you to think about what's happening. This is a liquid state, okay? Liquid, and this is our vapor. And this is for water, actually. We're looking at a heating curve for water. As you warm up, as you add heat to liquid water, it warms up. You're putting in thermal energy, it warms up. But at some point, it's going to reach a place where it's not warming up anymore, but it's boiling. And we're breaking those intermolecular forces, and we're turning them into the gas. During the course of the boiling, the temperature is not changing because all of the added heat, all the heat that you are putting in there, is going into breaking the attractions that we had between it. It's not going into giving them more kinetic energy and making their temperature go up. They're going into breaking those attractions. So during the course of boiling, we do not see a change in temperature. Now, when the temperature is changing, that's along these sloped areas, okay? We have an equation for that. We'll hold that equation for later. But the heat to change the temperature, so this is the place where the temperature is changing, is determined by how much we have, that's its mass, and how much heat we're putting in, and something that is called the specific heat capacity. Okay, each object has got its own amount of heat it takes to raise it a degree, and that's what that value is. We'll look at that equation later and measure it. But what I want you to see here is while a substance is undergoing temperature change, it's not changing state. But when you start changing state, when you start boiling it, you are not changing the temperature. And I want you to put that into your mind. Understand why all that added energy is going to breaking the bonds. But keep in mind, during the boiling process, the temperature is not changing. Okay, so we have looked at heat of vaporization, we've looked at vapor pressure, we've looked at the connection between vapor pressure and boiling point. We've seen how intermolecular forces and surface area affect, we've seen how intermolecular forces and temperature affect vapor pressure and boiling point.